Turn to your neighbor and say, it's game day. Yeah, and you're probably wondering why I have these gloves on, and I just want to talk Super Bowl for a bit with you. Some of you are like, what the crap? Those have nothing to do with Super Bowl. And you're right. It's just basically I just wanted to wear some gloves. And I didn't have football gloves, because really, what are football gloves? Just things with duct tape on them or something? I honestly don't even know. So here we are, game day. How many of you honestly, and I don't mean like you can just, you know, kind of put your hand up like sheepishly if you want, but how many of you are actually stoked for Super Bowl today? Okay, there's a few. There's a few people that are actually football fans. I see Natasha repping the Patriots. I'm not judging you, but I am. Today's game is between the New England Patriots, boo, and the Atlanta Falcons, yay. All right, so you can see where my allegiance lies, but interestingly enough, I'm actually not an Atlanta Falcons fan. I'm a diehard, for those of you that know me, I'm a diehard Philadelphia Eagles fan, but yes, there's one more. Oh, man. You need to come. No, I'm just doing it. I was just telling a guy this morning here, Troy, I seen this pie chart, actually, that showed, like, it was, like, showing all the people that were rooting for Atlanta in today's Super Bowl. And it showed this pie chart, the circle, and this little sliver was, like, actual Atlanta fans. And then the rest of it was, like, people who hate Tom Brady and the New England Patriots. And so I'm just being clear. I just want to lay this out on the line. That's me. I'm in that group. You know what? Because he's too good. Like, the Patriots are just too good. Every year, it seems, or every second year, they're playing in the Super Bowl. And honestly, it just kind of ticks me off, you know? And again, I know I'm only relating to the six people that raised their hand right now, but, I want to talk Super Bowl just for a brief moment because I think that it's interesting that, you know, like only six people in here, but yet how big of a day it is. And I know that it's American football and we got Canadian Football League and, you know, but I mean, I'm just a fan of football. I love watching football. And so you will actually get a kick out of this. Do you know, get this, 133 million chicken wings are eaten today just in North America. Turn to your neighbor and say, I could do that. Right? 133 million chicken wings. Did you know this? $222 million will today be spent on potato chips. $222 million. Yeah. I know. That's a fair bit, I would say. I mean, and obviously to keep it healthy, $13 million is spent on veggie trays. Yeah. Yeah, but honestly, those numbers actually pale in comparison. Get this, $1.2 billion is spent on beer. Turn your ears and say, oh, that's so unchurchy. $1.2 billion is spent on beer. And now get this, okay? Get this. On Monday, tomorrow, antacid sales go up 20 to 25%. Yeah. I know. But and here's the thing, because I know when we talk Super Bowl, we kind of talk, well, it's kind of like, well, more men watch it. No, that's true, but get this, 54 million women will tune in at 4:30 p.m. today to watch the Super Bowl. 54 million women. And obviously, these are just American stats, guys. This isn't including Canada. So 54 million and two, if you include Canada, right? But and Natasha, you're one of them, right? So, but 54 million women watch. Now, get this, though. One in 12 people that actually watch the Super Bowl only watch it. Guess for what? Why do they watch it? You guess. The commercials, that's right. Yeah, one in 12 people watch it for the commercials. Speaking of the commercials, $5 million in 30 seconds spent. Just like that. $5 million for every 30-second commercial. Can you imagine how much money that is? Like, you calculate over the course of the whole game how much ad revenue Fox is making from airing the Super Bowl. But I know that they say, actually, that Super Bowl commercials contribute to $2.19 billion in additional revenue for those advertising companies. So it actually goes to show that your $5 million can actually make some money, right? So who's up for spending that? Zero. Yeah, right. Super Bowl, you know, I'm a big fan of football, and you may or may not be, but I think that you probably are a fan of something, you know, whether it's music or whether it's theater or whether you're like a movie buff that you're always going to the latest movies that are coming out. I think that every single one of us kind of has things that we're, you know, passionate about, things that we enjoy watching, things that we enjoy, you know, experiencing, things that we enjoy seeing, and whether you're bent is like I say, theater, live theater, opera, you know, who knows? I really don't know kind of what your forte is, you know. But I think that every single one of us has something that, you know, we like doing, we like experiencing, we like watching, we like seeing, you know. And, you know, football is one, but I'm going to be real with you. I love hockey, you know, and especially love hockey now that the Oilers actually have a hope for making the playoffs. You know, because every other year it was kind of like, oh, yeah, hockey, we'll see, you know, I'll try and fit it in if I'm not fertilizing my lawn or something like that, right? But, you know, hockey for me, actually, I love watching hockey. In fact, last week, Pastor Frank Hackett and I and his son went to a Medicine Hat Tigers game. Have you guys ever been to a Medicine Tigers game? Yeah, a few of you. It's fun, hey? It's enjoyable to go and, you know, kind of cheer on our team. This is actually a picture of us at the game. And so naturally, because I was the one taking the selfie, I'm the one with the duck face. Frank is just like, what are you doing? You know, and that's actually his two kids there, Alec and Jesse. That's my one boy there, Javis. You know, actually Alec's real son, Alec, as you may know, Jesse is not, in fact, Frank's son. But Alec, he is a diehard Tigers fan. And now this is really weird because he lives in Cranbrook, B.C., they have a team there, the Kootenai Ice, right? But for some reason, he loves the Medicine Hat Tiger. I don't know if it's the colors. Honestly, I didn't even ask him as to why he loves. But so every time Frank comes here with the family, the four of us, or in this case, five of us, we went out to a hockey game to enjoy the Medicine Hat Tigers. And there's a purpose for me actually sharing all of this is, because there's two types of people that are in that arena at that present moment, aren't there? In any sports thing that you go to, there's always two types of people. In any theatrical play, there's always two types of people. In any, like, opera performance, there's two types of people. And so is the case with this hockey game. There's two types of people. There's spectators, and there's players. And so as you can see, we were actually sitting front row. Right, we thought, let's like make this an experience for Alec and for Javis, the kids. That's really who we were thinking about when we bought the tickets. Let's make it an experience that they would absolutely enjoy. And now, granted, my son, you know, he loves going to the concession stand and like, what are we getting next, Dad? I'm like, well, Dave, it's like the period's not ended. Yeah, but I'm just thinking already. What are we thinking we're going to get, you know? He loves those, like, the whatever, like anything there, the pretzels, the pop, you name it, you know? And really, I do too. It's kind of fun to go and spend $48 on a hot dog, isn't it, right? So here we are, you know, at the Tigers game, but you'll notice we're sitting front row. And let me tell you, I've never actually sat front row at a hockey game before. I've watched numerous hockey games on my couch or my Lazy Boy. I've watched numerous hockey games live. Years ago, I used to have like split season tickets with a friend. And so we've gone to numerous games, but I've never sat that close. And for those of you that don't know, when you sit front row, it's actually a whole different experience. Check out this next picture. This is a picture I took of how close you are to the game, right? It actually looks like game footage, like you're watching it on TV, right? We were so close that every hit that was along the boards, like you honestly, you kind of felt it. Like the boards would literally like move like a foot back and forth, the plexiglass, you know? And like, you know, being able to stand up when the Tigers scored and rap on the glass, you know, like those fans that you always see when they're playing hockey and you're just like, why do they do that? Well, you know what? It just comes part and parcel with sitting front row. You have to hit the glass, especially when the opposing team members are you know, plowed up against the plexi. You have to hit it, you know, to try and let them know that, hey, we're rooting for the other guys, right? But, you know, like sitting front row, those hits, rapping on the glass, you know, we were there early enough for pregame warm-up. And those of you that have ever been to pregame warm-up at a hockey game, all they do is shoot a whole lot of pucks at the net. And our seats were right behind the net. And so let me tell you, when that pucks come, like those come racing towards that plexi, you're putting a whole lot of trust in that half inch of plexi, let me tell you. Because my son, I think that he almost, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, when that puck was coming, he got so scared he almost lost his. It was scary. I'm not lying. Like, when those pucks were coming, I was ducking. I think Jesse, I don't know if he's in here or if he's in kids' church, but even he let out a, you know, like, they come racing pretty fast. They make a very loud noise. And honestly, it was fun. It was really neat being able to sit front row. You know, it's honestly, it's almost like, now get this, it's almost like we were in the game. Right, when you look at this picture, you're thinking, man, I could see that being my perspective if I was in the corner on the opposing team waiting for a pass or waiting for something. You know, it's almost like we were in the game. But we weren't. That half inch of plexiglass separated the players from the spectators. And now, granted, I'm sure that those guys probably have a little bit more skill than myself, Frank, or Jesse. So that might have separated us as well. But we weren't playing. We weren't in the game. We were merely watching. And now this is the thing, the life of a spectator, even as you can see from this picture, you only see what I'm showing you right now. And isn't that the life of a spectator? When you think about it, when you watch whatever you're watching, when you enjoy whatever concert you're at, when you, even like whatever the case may be, for whatever you're kind of like, bent is on being entertained, when it comes to the fact that you're a spectator, this holds true. Is a spectator, go ahead, only sees the excitement by what is shown them. Wouldn't you agree? Right? When you're at a concert, you don't hear the backstage stuff because they only show you what the best part of their band is on the stage. When you're at a hockey game or when you're watching a hockey game on TV, you only see what the cameras show you. When you're at a live game, you only see what happens on the ice. You don't get to experience and hear about what the coach is saying to the players on the bench. Spectators, they only see what's shown them. And now, some might say, well, that's okay with me. I'm fine with that. But I think that to be real with you, and I think that if you were real with yourself, being a player would be a whole lot better, wouldn't it? Right? Like, I think, like, you know, me, like, I played, you know, hockey as a kid and, you know, and like floor hockey. I mean, we never had, you know, the ability to play, mainly because we love church. And so, as you may know, if you register in hockey, you don't get to go to church from, like, October to March, right? So, we never played hockey, but I played a little bit of hockey with friends and ball hockey. I loved it, and I love going and watching the Oilers. I love watching the Tigers. I just really enjoy hockey. I love being a spectator, but being real with you, man, I would love to be a player. I would love to be able to play pro hockey. I mean, sure, I might not have the size for it. I might not have the physique for it. Some of you are like, what? No way, right? And I'm with you on that, right? But here's the thing, right? Is I would love to be a player, you know, because of the benefits that would bring. And I'm not just talking money. I'm just talking like, man, like when you can do something that you absolutely love and get paid for it, it's like, man, that is the best thing ever, isn't it? You know, or football, right? I mean, some of you would say, well, there's no way you could put pads on me and throw me in the Super Bowl. I like knowing up from down. I like knowing right from left, right? Like, you think one hit, and many of you have heard my football career story. You know, here it is really quick. It was one day, one practice, one hit, and I'm done. I thought I'd try out, and I thought I'd quit. That was all in the same day, pretty much, right? You know, but honestly, I think actually I would love to play in the Super Bowl. I mean, just think about the excitement that would bring. Think about, like, you know, the ability to, like, just experience the camaraderie between, you know, your teammates. Think about, like, you know, the intricacies of, like, the plays and, you know, and all these things. And just think about, like, the fact that, like, there's 100,000 people, like, cheering you on. And then there's another, like, 150 or 200 million people watching you online or on TV. Like, it just, to me, I just think, man, to be a player would be phenomenal. And here's the biggest difference, and some of you are like, well, there's obviously a big difference between spectators and players, but I think that the difference between a spectator is they only see excitement by what is shown them, but if you're a player, get this is what happens, is you experience excitement through engagement because you're actually engaged in what's going on. And now to me, I think, you know what, like spectating and engaging, yeah, they're two different things, but I think that even like the idea of being able to engage in something brings an excitement that I think is a little bit more permanent, isn't it? right? When you think of spectating, you think of like PVRing a hockey game. And the only way that you can kind of like relive that goal is by hitting rewind and watching it over again, right? But I think like that player has that memory built into them when they potted that goal, right? And I think it's the same for us in life when we think of like spectating and engaging, two very different things. And for some of you, I think that this is really real when it comes to following Jesus. I think that there's a whole lot of us, and myself included, where we tend to be spectators instead of players. You know, and there's kind of a myth, and you know, I don't necessarily know if it's a full-on myth, because I'm not gonna lie, I've felt like this, but you know, people might say, well, church is boring. People might say, well, you know, Christianity, being a Christian, that just sounds kind of boring. You know, and a lot of times those would be people that wouldn't have ever experienced it. Those would be people that wouldn't have ever lived, you know, life with Jesus. But honestly speaking, I think that I'm not going to ask you guys, but if you were to raise your hands and say, you know what, I've been bored with following Jesus before, honestly, I would be the first one to say, I've been there. Like many of you know, I grew up in church. I was born and raised from a fetus upwards in the church. I mean, this whole thing of following Jesus was always, you know, on my plate in front of me. This whole thing of like being in church was just something I've always experienced. But I would be lying if I told you that I have always been super excited with following Jesus. Because sometimes it's been boring. Sometimes it's been hard. Sometimes it's just been like, what? And I think if I were to ask you that, you would say, yeah, I've been there too. And this is the best thing about admitting that, well, you've been bored with church before, you've been bored with God before, is because I think you have an opportunity to engage instead of spectating. Because I think that, you know, if you were to ask the people that were super excited about following Jesus, the people that were like all in with like, this is the life, this is what I do, this is who I am, and, you know, I just love Jesus so much that I'm going to do whatever I can to be Jesus to other people, you know, like the people, and get this, the people that are the most excited about following Jesus aren't the ones that are just simply watching what he's doing. It's the ones that are actually engaging in what he's doing. Do you feel me? Do you get that? I think that for me in my life, the times when I've been most excited about what God is doing in my life and through my life and the lives of those around me, I think it's been when I've actually chosen to be engaged in the mission of Jesus Christ. And I think that you probably are the same. You know, the times when you could think like, man, I remember when I was just so jacked on God. I remember when I was just like, I was beaming who Jesus was. I remember that. I kind of reminisce. I kind of miss those times. But if you were to think about those times, it's probably, my guess, my opinion, is when you were actually engaged in what God was doing. There's a big difference between watching and actually playing. And I think today is your day. I think today is game day. Turn to your neighbor and say, yeah, it's game day. It's game day. Because this morning, I guess I just want to kind of give you a challenge to, you know, one of the staff members here says, Dave, I know what your life message is. You know how, like, preachers kind of always, you know, really, and some of you might agree with this, a lot of, like, what they preach is all centered around kind of one thing. And, you know, I would like to think, well, I just, my life verse is just Jesus' new command, go and love one another. You know, and so you would hear, like, that challenge coming from me numerous times over the course of the year, right? You know, just love one another. That's what it's about, you know. But she goes and tells me, I know what your life message is. It's simply this. It's to get people off the bench. And I'm like, well, I guess, yeah, I kind of see how that is. Because you know what? This whole idea of loving one another, it requires us to be not spectators, but to be players, doesn't it? And so this morning, I want to look at a portion of Scripture that, you know, at first glance, to be honest with you, it might be a little offensive. You know, it might step on your toes a bit. It might, you know, kind of make you cringe a little bit. But honestly, if Scripture doesn't challenge you, then you're reading the wrong Bible, you know. And so this morning, I want to look at a portion of Scripture in James to help us get to the place of saying, I'm getting off the bench. I'm going to play in the game. I'm going to be a player because, you know what, it's game day. And this is the, I guess this is the myth, you know, as we look at, you know, particularly as it pertains to the church of like Sunday being game day, you know. But realistically, guys, if you're a follower of Jesus, every day is game day. We have an opportunity as we live life, as we go out these doors. You know, we're only in here, guys, for an hour and a bit every single Sunday morning. We have an opportunity with the majority of our lives to make a difference in the lives of others. And the only way that we're going to do that is if we choose to get off the bench, as it were, to choose to engage, to choose to not be a spectator. Because spectators only see and they only experience what's shown them. And I think that you would much prefer to keep the excitement of Christianity because of what you're engaging in and because of what you're experiencing, not simply what you're seeing other people do. Amen? And so this morning, guys, I'm going to be real clear. Let's get off the bench. Let's look at James in this portion of Scripture where he's actually writing. And now James, for those of you guys that don't know, he actually was looked at as the leader of the church in Jerusalem shortly after the death and resurrection of Jesus. And he was a writer that honestly kind of wrote a little bit like Solomon. For those of you that have read, you know, like Proverbs, you know, where it was all these little like kind of proverbs and, you know, little like just kind of like one-liners type of thing. And James was a little bit like that. In fact, a lot of people would say that his book of James, you know, near the end of the Bible, is actually like the Proverbs of the New Testament. And what's neat about him is he didn't really beat around the bush. He just kind of said it how it was. And his whole kind of thing, if you were to look at the whole book of James, it was basically kind of like a how-to manual. Right, Paul had, you know, previously taught and previously wrote all about, you know, like how to, you know, like enter the faith, how to, like, you know, believe and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord so that you could be part of the family of God, you know. And James actually goes and takes it a step further, and he goes and he actually, the main part of his book is just simply kind of like how to do that. Okay, you've given your life to Jesus. You've decided to get baptized. Awesome, and that's awesome, that's great, but this is now how I can teach you, how I can show you how to actually live like a Christian. And really, I think the best way to look at it is he's all about engagement and not about just simply watching, not about seeing what other people showing you, but actually engaging and choosing what you get to experience for yourself. And so this is James chapter 2 in what he says. He says, "Dear friends," I love how he starts that. Right? Almost like, you know, and we can obviously understand the fact that he's speaking to the church. He's speaking to people that are believers. He's speaking to people, as it's defined actually in James, I think, as Christians, being part of the way, right? And so he's actually identifying, that's who I'm talking to right now. And so in the same way, okay, let me be real clear with you. If you're in here and you've never decided to make Jesus Christ your personal Lord and Savior, you know what? What I'm about to tell you doesn't necessarily apply to you. Right? But those of you that would be followers of Jesus, what we're going to look through in this portion of Scripture is so important for us in our daily walk with Jesus and our daily walk with God. Dear friends, do you think you'll get anywhere in this if you learn all the right words but never do anything? Turn to your neighbor and say, ouch. Sometimes Scripture can do that, can't it? Where it just can kind of challenge us. And you hear me pray every single morning, God, would you inspire us? God, would you challenge us? And God, would you change us? Well, right here, this is a verse that could potentially change your life. Because what here James is saying, he's like, do you think that you can just learn all the things about Jesus? Do you think that you can just, you know, let me modernize it. Do you think that you can just come and just sit in church and just learn about Jesus but not actually apply what Jesus teaches you? Do you think that you'll get anywhere in this life? Like, honestly, when you look at that, it's kind of like an all talk, no action type of thing. And I'm just being real, but I am so very blessed that my wife chooses to back her love up with action and not just words. Men, guys, this Valentine's Day, don't just make Valentine's, oh, honey, I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you. Do something about it. Choose to elevate, choose to honor her and women the same way. Like, don't just say, I love you, honey, I love you, honey, I love you, honey. Do something about it. And that's exactly what James is saying here. Do you think you'll get anywhere? And here, let me be real clear, okay? Because some of you might be thinking this is a little bit legalistic, okay? I am not talking about salvation. I am not talking about the fact that God gave his son, Jesus, for us freely, that if we just simply chose to believe in him, that we would have eternal life with Jesus and this life and life abundant that Jesus talks about in John 10:10. That's not what James is talking about. Salvation is given to us. The Bible says in Ephesians, it's by faith or by grace through faith. Anyone can choose to follow Jesus. That's why Jesus looked at Matthew, the worst sinner that was around, the whole area that he was in. He looked at Matthew and he said, follow me. It didn't require him to do anything. It just required him to choose to believe in who Jesus was. That's not what James is talking about. James is actually talking about if you've made that decision and you just look at this life of Jesus of simply learning more about him, and just soaking up all the information that you can so that you know the right words to say when you have the opportunity to say those words, but you don't actually do anything about it, you're not going to get anywhere, right? A lot of times, I don't have my Bible up on the stage, but a lot of times we look at the Bible, and I know you've heard this before, but, you know, we look at the Bible and we just think, like, it's so full of information. I just want to read and read and read and read and read and read and just soak it up and soak it up. You guys, that is awesome. But the Bible was not given to us. The scriptures were not given to us merely for informational purposes. Scripture was given to us for life application and transformation so that we could go from the dark to the light, so that we could go from being self-centered to Christ-centered, so that we could go from being selfish to selfless, so that we could go from hate to love. That's why we have scripture. That's why God gave his Bible. That's why God gave his son. And that's exactly what James is talking about. Dear friends, do you really think you're going to get anywhere in life if you just have all the right words, but you don't do anything about it? I liken it, you know, to football. And I just think, like, what if this coach is sitting and telling, you know, this star player, this guy that's going to be great, and he's just like, just giving him the works of like, man, you've got it in you. You know what? Like, I know you can do this, and you can go and win the game, and, you know, you like, and spends hours upon hours of training and studying the playbook and all these different things. And then when given the opportunity, the coach says, are you ready to play? The guy says, no. Like, we laugh at that, but realistically, don't we do that as Christians sometimes, right? Don't we kind of like look and just think, man, God is so great because my Bible tells me he's so great. But we don't actually choose to take a step towards somebody that needs to understand the love that we know so much about. Guys, this should challenge you. This should make you squirm. Guys, when I was studying for this, I was like, man, oh, I do this. God, this is me right here. I come up and I talk about loving your spouse, and I come up and say, guys, we need to choose love, but a lot of nights I sit on my butt and watch hockey instead of spending time with my wife. Guys, I come up here and I say, guys, we need to be slow to anger and slow to speak, but we need to be quick to forgive. You know, I come up here and I preach that and I speak that out and I say that's what we need to do. And then I go home and I'm super quick to anger with my kids. I'm just being real with you. I'm included in that. Those of you that are feeling right now like, wow, this is really hitting me hard. Hey, I'm with you. Again, when I was studying this, I was just like, God, forgive me. Because I do this. I live this sometimes. God, I say one thing, and this is the biggest thing. I know what I should do, but sometimes I just don't take that step. Right? James actually goes and he continues on in this scripture. This is what he says. He says, isn't it obvious that God talk without God acts is outrageous nonsense. Like, wow. And guys, here, just so you know, I'm reading out of the Message this morning, the Message version of the Bible. And I think it's a very clear representation of, you know, kind of modernized language for us today. And for those of you that are like a little bit on the fence saying, well, its Message isn't really a version of the Bible, let me just hear, this is what James says. James actually goes and he says, because this whole portion, this whole thing is about our faith and our works. This whole idea is like our faith based in like, this is who Jesus is. This is who Christ is for me in my life. And then there's the works end of it, right? This is James' version in the NIV of this portion of Scripture. He says, faith without works is dead. Eugene's version is simply, it's outrageous nonsense to think that we can have this faith but not do anything about it. Again, thinking of the sports analogy, I think of like the player who's like all smack, just talking trash all the time. Like, I've got game, I've got it in me, I'm the best ever, you know? And then when he gets on the field, you're like, no, you don't. You suck, actually. Some of you might be offended I said suck. I'm sorry, I won't say suck anymore in church, okay? It was so sucky of me. Think of that athlete, right? We look at that athlete, right, that would talk smack, talk trash. I'm the best. I've got game. Practice? Don't talk to me about practice, right? Like, we look at those guys, and if they don't have game, what do we call them? Posers. Fakes. I don't know if you're catching where I'm going this morning. But this idea of God talk without God action, it's just as James says, it's outrageous nonsense. And guys, this, honestly, I know that, you know, your toes might be getting stepped on right now, but I think every now and then we need to kind of go back to the basics of who we are as Christians and who we are as people, right? Like Jesus said, follow me. He didn't say, believe in me, learn everything about me, know everything about me, just be content with worshiping me in song. Read my Bible so that you can just learn more about me. No, Jesus said, follow me. And Jesus, let me tell you, he took some God steps that we'll never be able to take. And he backed it up with his God talk. Now, here, this is important, okay? Because a lot of us now, you might be feeling like this pastor is being quite legalistic right now. It's all works. And we know, we understand that it's not by works that any of us are saved. But I'm just saying, I'm throwing this out to you, that if you have given your life to Jesus and you would declare him as your Lord and Savior, then it's my opinion that you should be absolutely motivated to back up your God faith, your God talk, with your God actions. And I'm just being real. I don't think that's out of line for me to even throw that out to you. Because it's not my opinion, it's the Bible's. And if there's one thing that we know and we stand on here at Bridge Church, is the Bible is the authority. So that, guys, this isn't my opinion. This isn't, you know, me like saying like, hey, we don't have enough people helping out. It's game day. Get off the bench. Let's play. It's not about that. I'm trying to help you live the life that God wants you to live. James goes on in this portion of Scripture, and this is kind of the example he gives. He says, suppose a friend comes to you with no money and no clothes and asks for help. And our response is this. And now, oh, this is so harsh. God bless you. God bless you. I'll pray for you. Go in peace. Holy Spirit be upon you. All the right words, all the right things that we're taught to believe and we're taught to say and we're taught to speak over different scenarios, and that's awesome. But this is what James says. He says, what have you done? You've done nothing. You've just said, go in peace. Bless you. The Lord be upon you. I'm praying for you. That's honestly, guys, that's outrageous nonsense, as the Bible declares it. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's going to get better. Because I know, guys, I know when I'm studying this, when I'm reading this, I'm like, God, this is this is pretty fresh. Like, this is, you know, like kind of like borderline. Like, really, this is really challenging. And some of you might be thinking, again, like on that line of like, well, it's like legalistic or, you know, like, honestly, I just feel, and I might be going way out on a limb here, but I think that if you're even questioning, like, should I do this? Then maybe I'm just throwing this out. Maybe you just really need to revisit your faith. Because the Jesus that I know, the Jesus that I fell in love with, the Jesus that I gave my life to, gave it all. And so if I can sit here and declare him as my personal Lord and Savior, I don't think it's out of character to say, I want to give my all as well. So, James continues on, and, you know, I guess one thing I just want to kind of throw out to you here is those of you that are maybe challenged with this idea of maybe my God talk or maybe my God walk needs to match my God talk, but I think that, you know, some of you might, and I'm just being real, this is some of the things that I struggled with as I was studying this. I started thinking, well, but God, sometimes I don't have what it takes. Sometimes I don't think that I have the skill to really match up with the faith that I have. And you know, let me just throw this out to you here. Is God is more concerned about your availability than your ability? A lot of times we think we have to have it all together. A lot of the times we think we have to know all the answers. A lot of the times we think we have to like know the details and know how to and everything like that. But sometimes God is just willing and are ready for us to be willing to take that step. You know, like, I just liken it to maybe here at church, you know, like, you might not know how to operate a computer to run kids check-in, but let me just ask, would you be willing to try? Right? You might not know or have the skills to, like, greet people with the amazing smile and hug that Karakoga gives every Sunday morning without it being awkward. You might not know how to do that, but I guess the question is, are you willing to try? You might not know how to operate the computers at the back to do the media or to do sound, but my question is, would you be willing to try? You know, a lot of us have faith. A lot of us have like this desire to know God more, and a lot of us know what God is asking us to do in following him, but sometimes it just takes that little nudge to actually take that step, doesn't it? And I guess that's what this morning's message is about, is hopefully to encourage you to maybe just take that step of deciding to let your God walk match your God talk. You know, even here's the thing, take church out of this. Take Sunday mornings out of this. Those of us that would say we're Jesus followers, we know that we're supposed to love one another. We know that we're supposed to help those less fortunate, right? We know all this stuff. But what if we actually took a step to say, you know what, this week I'm going to sign up and volunteer at the food bank. You know what, this week I know the Champion Center could use some help. You know what, this week my neighbor could get their driveway shovel. I could do that. Right? What if we matched our God talk with our God walk? The things that we know and believe that we're supposed to do, what if we did? I honestly, guys, I think that we would be a church unstoppable. I think that we would be a people unstoppable. That we would be absolutely irresistible. That we would be life-changing. Because without that, guys, we're just outrageous nonsense. And I don't want to be that. And I don't think you want to be that either. I think that you want to make change in the lives of the people that are around you. I think we have to be. That could be just my opinion, but I think we have to be. James goes and continues in 2 verse 18. He says, you can no more show me your works apart from your faith than I can show you my faith apart from my works. What he's talking about is this merging of our faith, this merging of what we understand about God, of who we know God is, and the things that he's asked us to do, the way that he's asked us to live. He's saying it's not, you don't just have faith. You have faith and works. They go together. They're two in one. Right? In the NIV, right, he says it actually I think even neater. He says, you show me your faith without works, and I will show you my faith by my works. Meaning, what do people see? Do they see your belief? Or do they see you actually acting out on that belief? James actually continues, and this is so great. This is what he says. Go ahead. He says, faith and works, works and faith, they fit together like hand in glove. Because a lot of times I think we have like, you know, this idea of faith, this is a dirty old gardening glove. But a lot of us might say, well, you know what, I love gardening. That's why I love getting on my knees in front of and pulling out all the weeds and, you know, and like just like seeing my flower garden thrive and just seeing all these things. Like, I love seeing that. And so we buy these gloves that kind of like show us, you know, like this is what, these are for gardening. But this is the thing, right, is would these gloves be gardening gloves if they were never used for gardening? No. They'd just be some material. And in the same way, me, I love dirt biking. These are my dirt biking gloves, right? And I love getting out on the open trail or like the skinny little trail or this massive hill climb that, you know, I could high mark over top of my friend Mike Napik, whatever. But I love dirt biking, and these gloves represent this dirt biking life that I live. But would they ever be dirt biking gloves if I never actually put them on and did something with them? It's the same way with our faith, guys. Whatever your bent of faith is, whatever you would say, that's my niche, that's my passion, that's my desire, we got to put the gloves on. That's what James is talking about. It's not just this idea of faith. Man, God is so good. I can't wait to see God move in my life. I believe that he can, and we got these different ideas, different bents, different passions, different avenues. Some of you might be grandparents, and you just say, I love my grandkids. You know what? Let me just brag on my parents. They don't just tell me that they love my kids. They show me they love my kids. They actively spend time with them. Even above the times when we ask them to free babysit for us. They actively show me that they love my kids by spending time with them and doing stuff with them. And it's the same way, whatever your bent is, whatever your passion is, I guess it's my challenge that however that looks for you, your bent and your challenge might be something way different than anyone else's. How many of you guys know what these gloves are for? How many of you know that I'm not going to put one on? But we've got different ideas of our faith. We've got different skills. We've got different avenues that we can like believe and seek. Some of you have a faith to see people healed. Some of you have just immense faith to say, God, I know that you want people well. But your faith is just sitting there on the ground doing nothing if you never step out and do something with it. Your faith is just sitting there on a table unless you choose to actually put it on. And now here's the best thing that I want you to leave today with is your faith, the purpose of your faith is made true when you put your hand in the glove. This, we know, we understand, yeah, it's a baseball glove. But if I never put it on, its full purpose isn't ever seen. Its full purpose never comes to fruition. And it's the same for your faith. It's the same for your desires. It's the same for your skills. Some of you might say, well, I believe God is my provider. I believe that God can do all things and work together all things for good. But we never actually choose to put the glove on by maybe honoring God with our tithes. Some of you say, I know and I love this church. It's made a difference in my life. But we never actually put the glove on to say, what can I do? How can I help? How can I serve? Because guys, Jesus has made an incredible difference in my life. Incredible. When I've been anxious, he's given me peace. When I've been without hope, he's given me assurance. I look at my family and I'm just like, God, I'm so blessed. You've given me 3 healthy kids and a beautiful, amazing wife. And honestly, I credit that all to God, whom is my provider, whom is my healer, is my protector. And I thank Jesus for those of you that would say, I follow him. I think you would be with me in that same boat of saying, he has made a difference in my life. And now just think of that difference. Think of that shift. Think of that change in your life. Wouldn't you want that for others? Wouldn't you want that for the people that maybe came in here for the first time? Wouldn't you want that for the person that you invited to church? Wouldn't you want that for your neighbor? Wouldn't you want that for the person who serves you coffee? Wouldn't you want that for the person who pumps your gas? What if, instead of just having this faith on this table that we look at and say, that's so great, that's so grand, this faith, this belief in who Jesus was, who he said he was, wouldn't it be great if we actually put them on? Because, guys, that's what faith is. Faith is choosing to take a step with God. Faith is choosing to put the gloves on, as James teaches us. They fit together like hand in glove. Today's takeaway is I will show my faith by what I do and how I live. And now, I just want to kind of end with this. This is a real cool thing, is when we choose to do this, when we choose to take those steps, when we choose to put those gloves on, you know what happens? We get excited. We get jacked. We get energized simply because of, guys, our engagement. And so, those of you know, when I was talking about maybe times in your life when you've been a little bit bored with Jesus, you've been a little bit bored even just with showing up at church week in and week out. You've just been a little bit bored with like, God, okay, I read your Bible, but I don't get anything out of it. Those of you that maybe just are a little bit bored with life, let me tell you, put the glove on. Whatever your bent is, whatever your passion is, whatever you know that would bring you energy, choose to take the step of engaging instead of watching, because it will bring an excitement that is not temporal, that is not dependent on other people, but it will bring an excitement in your life for who Jesus is and what he's doing in you and through you and around you like no other. Let's pray.